Now, this guy I'm about to introduce, I've known for years, met him as a hot instructor. Scott Thompson entered the fire service in 1982 as a volunteer while attending Texas A&M University. He began his paid career with the Plano, Texas Fire Department in 1986. Over the course of his career, he's worked in operations, training, and administration in multiple progressive fire department organizations. As chief of training for the Lewisville, Texas Fire Department, he was also a rescue diver and active in the pipes and drums. Over his career, he has received both a Valor Award and 4 life-saving ribbons. He has a bachelor's degree in emergency administration and planning and is a Texas certified public manager. In 2002, Chief Thompson co-founded the Heart of Texas chapter of the Fraternal Order of Leatherheads and remains a member today. He's passionate about company level training and developing higher performance learning cultures. Since 2009, he has led a chosen culture that has maintained a 96% retention rate with quality recruiting, a formal mentoring process, performance standards, and a risk management approach to problem solving. Chief Thompson currently serves as the fire chief in the Colony, Texas Fire Department. He has numerous articles published about leadership, training, command and control, suburban fire operations, and firefighter rescue and survival. He is author of the book, The Functional Fire Company, Positioning Small Groups for Success and Survival, published by Fire Engineering Books. He owns and operates Functional Fire Company, LLC, and fireserviceleadership.com. Please welcome a true revolutionary as this year's keynote speaker, Chief Scott Thompson.
Howdy, and good morning. Chief Rhodes, thank you for that very kind introduction. And by the way, I love what you've done to the place. Fresh paint, new curtains. Looks beautiful, brother. It truly is an honor to be here before you. The great, great opportunity. I welcome everybody. Those your first time, welcome to FDIC. Chief Rick Lasky brought me to my first FDIC in 2002 as part of the Saving Our Own hands-on training HOT program. To be honest, it was one of the best and one of the worst experiences in my almost 40 years of being a firefighter. You see, my first FDIC was the first FDIC after 9/11. So many that made FDIC what it is today were gone. It was an emotional week with many stories being told, some for the first time outside of the FDNY. God rest their soul. I've sat where you are sitting every year since, and thanks to Bobby Halton, I was treated to the full experience. 2015 was the first year one of my firefighter sons got to attend FDIC. It was a time when they were really cracking down on visitors at the hot site. I called Bobby to let him know my son would be joining me and to ask for a little leniency. Without skipping a beat, Bobby said, "Hey, have you heard about our new mentor program?" Not only that week did my son get to come out to the site, but he got to spend a few days with some outstanding firemen. To me, that was classic Bobby. Always finding a way to get it done, always finding a way to make people feel important. Bobby Halton was definitely a great influence on the American Fire Service. This morning, I would like to start out by talking about something that I'm very passionate about, something that influences every fire department organization, and that's culture. I have personally experienced the impact that culture can have on safety, on performance, and yes, on recruitment and retention. Putting safety into context, increasing performance standards, and recruitment and retention of highly capable people are topics that I believe are among the most important facing the American fire service from a leadership perspective. While it's important to make firefighters feel important, either through compensation or recognition, pay and benefits are just one of the many things we can do to take care of our firefighters. Committing to a chosen culture is another. As I was doing research for my book, I spent a year going to fire chief conferences and a year going to firefighter conferences. One of the things that I noticed immediately is that there weren't a lot of firefighters hanging with fire chiefs and not a lot of fire chiefs hanging with firefighters. Now you may be thinking, no kidding, each is staying in their lane. However, as the fire chief, if I hope to have a culture that values the things that are important to firefighters, I need to understand what firefighters need and what they want. If fire departments exist to solve problems, which I believe they do, we need a mission statement that should support all that we do, and the members of the organization should make that their number one priority. Chiefs, support staff, line officers, and firefighters each play a critical role in fulfilling the mission. With that being said, I see more and more mission statements hanging in headquarters like fine art with motivating words. I have seen mission statements that have no mention of saving lives or protecting property, the things most expected by our communities and by those we hire, at least the ones that get why we exist. We must remember that in this line of work, outcomes are often determined by seconds and not by minutes. We must recognize that our commitment to preparation and, yes, aggressive problem solving will have a significant impact on the outcome. However, it's when we use the word aggression that the conflict begins. Conflict occurs when we advertise for firefighters, when we conduct a hiring process aimed at hiring the best firefighters, but then we get them on board and we don't allow them to be firefighters. What we need to be thinking about when we craft our mission statement is what is expected by the public, and can an engine boss or a truck boss read the mission statement and understand what their role is in fulfilling the mission? How do I know what our citizens expect? I asked them a simple question. What do you expect from your fire department? Now, make no mistake, there is an expectation. There are three things that if the culture does or does not value, will determine who we hire, who we keep, and that highlights our commitment to the communities that we protect. The degree that culture values safety, standards, and the commitment to aggressive problem solving should be at the center of our fire service universe. Yet, each of these looks very different in fire departments across America. A commitment to safety is important, but we need to remember that firefighters and fire victims are both stakeholders when it comes to the topic of operational safety. Firefighter cancers, mental health, and managing operational risks at a professional level are things that we should be paying close attention to. We do need to do all that we can to protect our people, right up to the point that it takes seconds away from those that we have sworn to protect. We have more science and data to help us with our decisions than ever before. Nevertheless, we need to be careful about picking and choosing what data to follow based on personal comfort levels. We have the responsibility as public servants to pay much attention to the Firefighter Rescue Survey, Project Mayday, and the great work being done by UL as we do the data relating to cancer and mental health. We need to stop using the data as justification to be less aggressive problem solvers, and use it to train and prepare our firefighters so that they are in the best position to save lives and protect property. To hire and keep the best, we need to support a culture that values letting firefighters be aggressive problem solvers. We need to allow them to take pride in doing something that very few can or are willing to do. If we are to attract those that are dedicated to this calling, we must be okay with letting firefighters be firefighters. In the colony, Texas, we sum up our mission and the commitment to our people in a simple statement. We will come for you. As one of our captains puts it, this is our why. But it takes a big commitment to get there. We need people with good character who don't mind getting dirty and who are motivated to train because they realize that their success and survival depend on it, and not because it's a box to check on the monthly to-do list. We need a culture that values independent thinking and people who look for opportunities to solve problems, fire, rescue, and emergency medical problems. In 1992, I had the opportunity to spend some time with FDNY Lieutenant Pete Lund. Well, he was at Rescue 3. I was sitting with Pete at the kitchen table in the old firehouse, describing my experience. At 30 years old and somewhat new to the profession, I was somewhat overwhelmed and in awe of what I had seen and experienced. As I was telling the story, I remember Pete very clearly stopping me mid-sentence and saying, "Scott, you have every opportunity to be a firefighter in the highest level in Plano, Texas, where I was working at the time, as I do in the South Bronx. It's just going to look a little different." I understood the assignment from my friend and mentor. Look for opportunities to prepare, protect, and to save. His message changed the way that I looked at the day-to-day of being a firefighter. The opportunities are out there for those of us who choose to fulfill this calling at the highest level. Regardless, if you are a member of a rural volunteer fire department who must continually struggle for funding and staffing, or a thriving urban department, the opportunities are there. To best position firefighters for success and survival, and fire victims for survival and recovery, the culture must value training at the highest level. It must place less emphasis on fads and curb appeal, and more emphasis on our protective clothing, hose packages, and firefighter-friendly apparatus that maximize our problem-solving capability and minimize our zero-impact period. A culture that values minimizing the chance of injury while protecting property within the parameters of a risk management model based on our operational capabilities and limitations, and not emotion-based opinion. However, to make this mindset a reality, make it part of the culture, requires standards. Standards with accountability are the things that fire department system needs to make sure it operates at the highest level consistently. Fire victim and firefighter survival should not be determined by the personal preferences of the on-scene incident commander, but the conditions that brought us there. Personally, thank you. Personally, I want to hire and retain firefighters who want standards that they can define, demonstrate, measure, and improve. People who understand that they are the fire professionals and that the community that they swore to protect expect them to perform at a professional level. The type of firefighters that I'm fortunate to work with every day. I ask you, if not this, what? When I hear the word cowboy, I think of the 12-5, one and out Dallas Cowboys. Yeah. I think about how the fire service has weaponized the word to describe any activity on the fire ground that leadership feels uncomfortable with. Of course, being from Texas, I also think about the hardworking men and women who are a big part of our Western American heritage and the Texas Rangers. Not the World Series Texas Rangers, but the Texas Ranger Elite Law Enforcement Agency that was formed in 1823, who've always strived to live the cowboy way. You see, cowboys take pride in their work, caring for horse and cattle better than some firefighters care for people. I would call that compassion. They do what needs to be done without complaining or sense of entitlement. To me, this is work ethic. They ride for the brand with pride, dedication, and loyalty, something we should all think about in terms of retention. Cowboys are tough but fair and know where to draw the line. Traits of a good fire service leader, in my opinion. Yet when we, the American Fire Service, use the word, we use it to call out and discourage anything we are personally not comfortable with. Now, I'm not in any way endorsing freelancing or reckless fireground actions. I'm talking about being mentally and physically ready to do the job that all of us signed up to do. Some of my best hires have been veterans and those that live the cowboy way. Firefighters who want to be well-trained, well-led, supported, and appreciated. Following the shooting in Columbine, Colorado, that claimed the lives of 13 innocent victims, first responders received a black eye from the public, claiming that we failed to respond in an aggressive, problem-solving manner. 20 years later, Parkland, Florida, another 17 dead, and once again, first responders did not meet the public's expectations. Following this event, Denton County Sheriff Tracy Murphy, a former Texas Ranger, had the following words to put out to his agency, and I quote, "With the recent tragedy in Florida, I want to make clear my policy on responding to an active shooter. All commissioned deputies, if you respond to an active shooter, you are expected to take immediate action. We do not stage and wait for SWAT. We do not take cover in the parking lot, and we do not wait on another agency. We go in and we do our duty. We engage and stop the shooter, and we save lives." This is a powerful statement. Was the purpose of Sheriff Murphy's message to encourage his deputies to be reckless cowboys, as some in the fire service would call it? Was he disregarding the safety of his officers? Not at all. His message was not telling his deputies that they were worth any less than the people in that school. What he was telling them was to be ready to do the job that they all signed up to do. He was positioning them for success and survival by providing a standard and for allowing them to do their job. He was putting safety into context, establishing a response standard, and telling his deputies they better be cowboy ready. Now, as I read through this, I thought, what can the fire service learn from this? What can we learn from law enforcement and their response to active shooters? I thought to myself, what will be the event that causes a community, those who pay for our existence, to evaluate and become activists in demanding that we operate differently? Will it be the fire department that fails to perform VES or rescue the family that was instructed to sleep with their door closed because VES is just too dangerous? Will it be the career fire department that shows up with 20 paid personnel, millions of dollars of apparatus and equipment, and an ISO 1 classification, who immediately goes defensive at the first sign of fire through the roof? And most recently, the shooting in Uvalde, Texas, that claimed the lives of 19 students and two teachers. In the wake of this event, the United States Department of Justice and the Texas House of Representatives both issued investigative reports to the response to Robb Elementary. The Justice Department's report looked at tactics, leadership, incident management, and the coordination of operations, finding faults with each. The Texas House of Representatives report concluded the following. At Robb Elementary, all law enforcement responders failed to adhere to their active shooter training, and they failed to prioritize the lives of innocent victims over their own safety. The report went on to say all officers must now acknowledge that the stopping the killing of innocent lives is the highest priority in an active shooter response, and that all officers must be willing to risk their lives without hesitation. So, why focus on law enforcement at a firefighter conference? This is not intended in any way to be a political statement, but rather to point out the power of public perception. If I would have stood before you in 2019 and said in 2024 there'd be talk about defunding the police, I would lose all credibility. Yet here we are. Why must we recognize this? Because fire and EMS are typically the next biggest piece of the budget pie chart. I fear that if we do not stay vigilant to our mission and committed to our purpose, the fire service may very well be subject to the same amount of scrutiny as our brothers and sisters in blue. If we continue the debate on who is more important, firefighters or fire victims, we may very well have that answer provided to us. If we continue to ask for more and more, yet do less and less, that's a bad investment in an unsustainable position. If we don't shift our mindset from being safe to identifying, prioritizing, and managing risk, and then base our level of operational commitment based on capabilities and limitations, we too, the American Fire Service, could very well have our people defending our actions, our decisions, and telling us how we will respond and the risks that we must be willing to take. If we continue the narrative, it's too dangerous to search off the line or work above the fire. And if we fail to consider the threat to fire victims, we too may very well be told how to do our job. We are foolish to think it could never happen to us. Now, some may be getting the impression that I don't take firefighter safety seriously. In fact, it's quite personal to me. The mental and physical well-being of firefighters and risk management is personal because I have family on the job. Every time I make an operational decision, rather in policy or on the fire ground, I think of these two pictures. I think of my two sons, and while they don't work for me, when making a decision, my sons represent the men and women of the Colony Fire Department. I have never, nor would I ever, make a decision that I would not be okay with my sons being governed by. On the other side of the coin are my five grandbabies. They represent the people I swore to protect. I am committed to building a culture, a response model, and an operational commitment that I hope is in place in the fire department that protects them in the unfortunate event they ever experience a fire. Now, I challenge each of you in attendance this morning to make risk avoidance and risk acceptance personal. I ask you to think about this. The greatest investment in any fire department organization is in fire rescue and fire suppression capabilities. I ask, what are you doing to maximize that capability? I hope each of you here this morning understand the assignment. Prepare, protect, and save. In closing, I want to thank my wife, Pam, and my sons, Garrett and Braden, for their love and support. Thank you to Chief Rhodes, Diane, and the advisory board for bringing me back and for giving this opportunity to share my message. And thank you to the men and women of the Colony Fire Department who make it all work and who have set the standard for the suburban fire service. Thank you, God bless, and have a wonderful FDIC. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Stay out here with me.
All right.
Woo! I may come out of retirement and go start working in Texas. Man.
Thank you, brother.
Come on, stay up here with me. All right. The end of opening ceremonies, day one. I hope you get a lot. Hope you got a lot out of this. Together we can take on the big issues. I want to thank Chief Malone, Mayor Hoxett, for all the support. Dr. Lori, who's working hard to pull us together. Chief Scott Thompson, who's showing us that we can be aggressive and safe and create a culture of loyalty and success. I want to thank all those partners that have supported me in my first year in FDIC. It includes ISFSI, Women in Fire, Fire Nuggets, ULFSRI, the Cancer Support Network, the National Volunteer Fire Council, the IAFF, all the instructors and authors, and you revolutionaries working hard to change the world. Go learn something and pass it on. Thank you. Thank you.